Greetings, comrades. Technopoles, science parks, innovation centers, high technology clusters. What do you think of when you hear those words? I suppose Silicon Valley comes to mind first. Tall buildings, offices of the world's leading research organizations, universities, financial institutions. Now imagine similar specialized high-tech cities, but in Russia. Believe me, Russian technopolises don't look like Silicon Valley, Route 128, or even the Trieste Area Science Park in Italy at all. Nevertheless, Russia has 14 scientific technopoles of a special type, which are called Naukograds, and there are about 50 cities seeking this title. These are special cities with high concentration of research and development facilities, some of them built specifically by the Soviet Union for these very purposes. Let's take a look at what these cities are, why they were built, and what do they look like today. So what exactly are these mysterious cities, Naukograds? In fact, it is already clear from their name. Nauka is from the word nauka, science. Grad is an old-fashioned word for city. So Naukograd can be translated as science city. According to the most recent definition, Naukograds are cities or parts of cities with high intellectual, scientific and technical potential, high concentration of scientists and specialists working in scientific, educational or industrial organizations and enterprises. Accordingly, they now exist for the same purpose as all other high-tech clusters, to enable large corporations and small businesses to develop knowledge-intensive technologies around educational and research institutes. This is how it should work, ideally. However, I will tell you frankly, I have lived in one of Naukograds for about 5 years. Did I feel that I live in a high-tech city, a place where the best minds of the country push science and technology forward? No, not really. And let me tell you why. And we will start, as always, with some history. As I said, many Naukograds were built by the USSR literally from the ground up. Indeed, the very concept of separately designated science cities sounds like something that should have been invented by the Soviet Union. Special places where the country's elite can move science forward without being distracted by anything else. But strangely enough, formerly the first Naukograd did not officially appear in Russia until the 1990s, after the collapse of the USSR. Such a concept simply did not exist under the Soviets. Although, of course, the specialized science cities themselves did exist. But there was another term, closed cities. Closed cities were established in the Soviet Union from the late 1940s onwards, under the euphemistic name of post boxes, referring to the practice of addressing posts to those cities via mailboxes in other cities. Most often, they were small communities with sensitive military, industrial or scientific facilities, such as arms plants or nuclear research sites. Even Soviet citizens were not allowed access to these places without proper authorization. They were often established in remote places situated deep in the Urals and Siberia, out of reach for enemy bombers. It could have been a plutonium production plant or uranium enrichment facility, or just an aircraft engine plant. Imagine a whole city with tens of thousands of people living as if under a dome, surrounded by double or triple fences with several security checkpoints, cut off from the outside world in an atmosphere of extreme secrecy. But I got sidetracked. Why did I bring up closed cities? What do science cities and closed cities have in common? They have a common principle. One large enterprise which employs most of the adult population of the city, while the city is built exclusively in order to maintain and support this very enterprise. And nowadays, some formerly closed cities have become science cities in Russia. That is, in fact, there were two types of specific scientific cities in the USSR. The first were specialized scientific settlements. Formerly, they were called settlements of urban type with a high concentration of intellectual, scientific and technological potential. They emerged in the 30s and such cities were Zhukovsky, Korolev, Dzerzhinsk, Fryazino. They were not closed, they could be freely visited by Soviet citizens, and enterprises in these cities were engaged not only in the military development, but also in quite peaceful scientific research. The city of Zhukovsky, which became the center of aviation science in Russia, deserves special mention. It can be considered the first Soviet science city. Symbolically, it was also the first to be designated a Naukograd title after the collapse of the Soviet Union. The second type of science cities were those very closed cities, and 90% of the country's population prior to the collapse of the USSR had absolutely no idea that those cities even existed. There were almost 100 such cities in the USSR, and of course, not all of them were involved in any high technology research. Some of the closed cities, after being declassified, turned out to be just regular military towns, where some secret military unit was located. At the same time, many of the open cities in the Soviet Union, such as Протвино or Дубна, were engaged in fundamental research in nuclear physics or in designing nuclear reactors, which means that logically these cities should have been closed, but they weren't. So let's not even try to understand the logic of the Soviet authorities. In this video we will focus only on those cities that are recognized by Russia as Naukograds, the cities whose main mission is scientific activity. They may or may not have been closed during the Soviet era, it doesn't matter. A total of 14 such science cities now officially exist in Russia. Бийск, Дубна, Жуковский, Кольцово, Королёв, Мичуринск, Обнинск, Петергоф, Протвино, Пущино, Реутов, Троицк, Фрязино, Черноголовка. Of those, 9 were built virtually from scratch during the Soviet era. So, the appearance of a typical modern Russian science city was determined precisely by the Soviet period of the country's life. Therefore, let's take a look at how the USSR planned and built such cities. The Soviet urban planning idea was almost constant throughout the Union's existence. First, this idea was described as a garden city, then as a Soцгород, and then as a Soviet workers' settlement. But the garden city idea of the English utopian sociologist Ebenezer Howard was never brought to reality in the Soviet Union. The Soviet workers' settlements, on the other hand, became a real thing. Urban planning in the USSR addressed tasks of a purely practical nature. Specifically, science cities were supposed to ensure the USSR's leadership in advanced technology and industries. In order to do so, the construction of each individual city was carefully thought out. Plans for general area zoning, layouts of industrial enterprise and settlements, energy hubs, rail, road and waterways, water supply and sewage schemes, engineering preparation of the territory, etc., etc., were drawn up. Thus, in fact, 100 years ago, the current phase of Russian science cities was predetermined. At the heart of those cities were design bureaus or research institutes. There were cities with one huge enterprise as a center, for example, Protvino, and cities where several facilities of a similar profile were concentrated, such as Pushchino or Zhukovskiy. Their specialization may have been very different, but they can be divided into seven general sectors: space research, aircraft technology and rocket science, radioelectronics, nuclear research, instrumentation engineering, power engineering, chemical engineering, and biotechnology. What all these cities had in common was that their scientific enterprise was their alpha and omega, the beginning and the end. Everything else around this enterprise was purely secondary, clearly planned and divided into zones for maximum labor efficiency. Here's the zone where the Soviet citizen works, here's where he takes a walk and breathes some fresh air, here's where he is culturally developing, and here's where he sleeps before the next productive working day. And nothing can be changed. Ideally, a science city should be an integrated triad of science, production and education. As a rule, it consists of centers of fundamental and applied science and experimental industrial production of the respective profile, a research institute, a design bureau, a pilot plant, testing facilities and a university. Around 30-50% of city residents work at this very enterprise and are high-class specialists with a university degree. The rest of the residents are members of their families or, shall we say, service personnel. It is worth noting, however, that the Soviet Union has really thought carefully about the quality of life in these cities. Science cities were the elite among Soviet cities. These cities were comfortable for the Soviet citizen to work, live decently and have a pleasant leisure time. There was a balance between industrial and residential development, a well-developed sphere of culture and consumer services, high level of urban amenities. Moreover, even in the face of Soviet deficits, the cities were always supplied with everything necessary. It allowed scientists in these cities to work really efficiently and to maintain a higher level of scientific activity for the Soviet Union. But it also led to the fact that 30 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, most science cities are not having the best time of their lives. it seems like they are stuck in the past and do not wish to evolve. Naukograds are a unique phenomenon created by the Soviet Union. They became centers of attraction for the best Soviet specialists, unique scientific equipment. They were the generators of the ideas that moved the Soviet Union forward. That said, it is hard to find any other communities so socially spoiled by their communist past and so unfit for the market economy conditions. When the USSR was alive, the whole city existed in order to make it comfortable for high-class specialists to work there. The USSR collapsed and there was simply no one to maintain this comfortable urban environment. In the absence of the main initiator and the biggest consumer of their services, the Soviet military-industrial complex, the demand for science cities sharply diminished. The amount of state orders decreased by an order of magnitude. People were simply not getting paid for the work they already did. Classical Soviet closed cities and classical capitalism with its market relations have almost no points of contact with each other. The large city-forming enterprises in the new conditions could not ensure the normal operation not only of their production but also of the social infrastructure facilities, for which they were suddenly responsible. City authorities and the heads of enterprises made a lot of efforts in order to adapt somehow to the market situation. But for the first time in the history of the closed cities, there was a real danger of a brain drain. In the past, the Soviet state assigned you to a certain institute in a certain city, where you then worked for the next 40 years. But now, the whole world is open to you. You can go to the US and get a job there, and because of your unique knowledge, they are willing to pay you a good salary. And at your institute, they don't pay you at all. So the choice was obvious. Those researchers who did not want to leave Russia, oddly enough, still wanted to eat. And so they left science for private businesses or other industries. As a result, Russian science cities were left without their main value, their scientists. As a result, there was a paradoxical situation in Russia in the 1990s. Because of their unique potential, science cities could have opened up new horizons for economic revival in Russia, become the core of Russian technopolises and elite university towns, become centers of regional development and interaction. However, instead, they almost turned into ghost towns. Fortunately, there was a timely Union for the Development of Science Cities, which managed to get the Russian government to give their cities a special status of Naukograd, and in addition to the special status, some benefits and privileges that helped these cities and their enterprises not to go bankrupt. However, this was still not enough. Therefore, at the moment, the majority of Russian science cities are stuck somewhere in the middle. They have not collapsed, but they have not become centers for new high-tech industries either. They are not dying, but they are not really evolving either. They no longer work solely for the state, but they do not attract private investors very actively, and the state is not very keen to develop them, focusing instead on their new, more expensive and progressive toys, which we will talk about in the next section. So, I think you can already picture a typical portrait of a Russian science city. A small town, as if stuck in the Soviet times, which is built around some large state enterprise, where the state is the main and only customer. The Russian government understood that it is almost impossible to develop such cities under capitalist conditions. So it came up with the concept of a new type of science city. The best known of them is Skolkovo, a science and technology innovation center for the development and commercialization of new technologies, which began to be built in 2011 in cooperation with MIT. Its main difference from traditional Soviet science cities is the word commercialization. The project envisaged creation of a favorable environment for concentration of Russian and international intellectual resources capable of generating innovative technologies. That is, in fact, it was meant to be a science city whose customers would be not the state, but various Russian and international private companies. It was also agreed to get rid of the narrow specialization of science cities. Skolkovo was to become a development center for any type of science, from microbiology to astrophysics. The project was announced as Russian Silicon Valley, but so far, of course, it has not become any kind of Silicon Valley. Another example is Innopolis. Innopolis was built exactly in the Skolkovo image and is located near Kazan. It has a more pronounced specialization and is aimed at the IT sector, but the principles are exactly the same. A special economic zone exempt from almost all taxes into which all enterprises focusing on innovative technologies are supposed to migrate. The Technopolis Jazz in the Kaliningrad region and the Sirius village near Sochi are also under construction and have the same principles. The only problem is that all these modern technopolises are killing the existing science cities. Cities and enterprises with nearly a century of experience that have kept the USSR among the world's leading powers. Huge amounts of money have been invested in them in the past. These cities have excellent scientific potential, but instead of developing and modernizing them, billions of dollars have been spent on building new, modern and for now practically useless innovative technopolises. About 170 billion rubles have been allocated for Skolkovo alone since 2010. This is 15 times more than what the federal budget annually allocates to all of Russia's science cities combined. Actually, right now Russia is repeating the situation of the 90s. Only brains are flowing away not to America, but to Skolkovo. This is better, of course, but just a little bit better. The result is a paradoxical situation once again. There are cities in Russia where the entire infrastructure is geared up for the most comfortable scientific and innovation activity, and which have colossal experience in that sphere. And there are cities in Russia in which enormous funds are injected for the creation of comfortable environment for development and commercialization of new technologies. What is the problem? The problem is that these are different cities.